Yeah, so we were talking about a few Sundays back about zeal, and we were trying to understand what is zeal all about. The following Sunday, we also spoke a little bit about knowledge, because we learned that zeal without knowledge is not good. Okay? Zeal without knowledge is not good. And in fact, I gave you, let me just pull up that page here. And you know, we also told you that zeal without knowledge and knowledge without zeal, it's like I do something but know nothing. I do something but know nothing. The other way around is knowledge without zeal. I have something but do nothing. Although I know something but do nothing. The first one is I do something but know nothing. I know something but do nothing. So zeal without knowledge and knowledge without zeal is as good as no good. So you need both combination together for you to do, or rather to think of doing something great for the Lord. So last time we also spoke to you about the definition of zeal. We'll not go into detail. We spoke some Greek understanding of what is zeal. Zeal is, in another easy word, is ferventness in the spirit. It's being hot. It's always being excited. Paul encourages mostly all the churches in the letters. If you read Paul's letters, he says that be fervent in the spirit. Be zealous. Be fervent in the spirit. You know, we need, and I told you some of the points last time. What is the issue? Why are we not zealous at times? What is stopping us from being zealous for God? We spoke on Romans 10:2. That was one of our groundwork. We spoke on Romans 10:2. We said that, you know, Paul said, I can assure you that they are deeply devoted to God, but their devotion is not based on true knowledge. We also spoke about how do I increase zeal. I don't want to spend too much time on this because I want to move ahead. I want to get these two together. Yeah. So we spoke about how do I increase zeal. If you want to get excited in the Lord, there is certain efforts that you have to make. If you do not make those efforts, you can never be zealous for God. You will tell me, no brother, I'm okay with what I am. I have knowledge, that is enough. I don't want to move. If you don't want to move, then you know God is not able to, it's not, cannot work on you. You have to move, right? You got to say, Lord, I am available. You can use me. But if you're available, then you better start moving. You see, right from the book of Genesis to the book of Revelation, or rather from the Old Testament, if you read, God, when he got people to do something for his kingdom, they had to move from one soil to another soil. Abraham, God said, Abraham, come out, go to another land, move, move. What happened to Joseph? He was moved to another land. Finally, he landed up in Egypt. Every one of them, they had to actually physically move. Got my point? Many people say, okay, I'll spiritually move. Good, you have to move spiritually as well, but you got to be prepared to move physically. What do you mean by physically move? You got to be prepared to say, if Lord is telling you, I want you to go there right now. You cannot say, no, I will sit here right now. No, I will do everything by sitting. Or I'll do everything electronically. No, God is saying that you got to move from which, if you're sitting in this chair, you got to move from this chair to this chair. From this chair, God will never allow one person to be in one place. He'll never allow you to sit in one place for a long time. You know, somebody said, if your Christian life is very comfortable, then there is something wrong with you. Amen. Who said amen? Yes. Amen to you back. How many of you are comfortable as a Christian? Now all are looking at me. If I say yes, no, what to do? What do I mean by comfortable? Am I saying that you all have to struggle? Is that what I mean to say? I don't mean to say that you got to struggle in Christian life, but I mean to say that your Christian life is very adventurous. You know, if you go to SL World, some of their rides, and you go to those, no problem. Look here, concentrate on me. If you go to SL World, yeah, you go to some rides over there, what happens? You get excited, right? Sometimes you go to that rainbow ride in SL World, it goes like this up and goes down. I've not been there for a long time, planning to go. And that really gets you excited, right? So, and they say that people who are heart patient, please don't sit on such rides. Yeah? Because that gets you excited. Your Christian life has to be exciting. Understanding my point? It cannot be, I don't like to use the word that it's full of troubles and worries and... No, no, no. Troubles and worries are there, that's why your life is exciting. Are you getting my point? Hallelujah. No, Jesus was an adventurous man. He was always moving. Half of the time, he was only moving around the place. You notice that? When he started his ministry, he was never at one place. He was always moving around. What was he doing? His ultimate goal was to reach the gospel, to tell people the kingdom of God, to tell people that, you know, that you have to repent, you have to accept. He was telling people about his claim that I am the Son of God. As a church, as a family, as a Christian family, you need to understand that I cannot live a comfortable life. You got to be prepared that God is going to use you mightily. And if God starts using you, it is much more exciting than the SL World ride. Hallelujah. Because it's not only going to be spiritual, it's also going to be materially. It's also going to be, the provisions that God gives you in your life. So you got to understand this point. I have to be zealous for God. Don't ever believe this lie that no, I will do what I'm doing and I will not do something exciting, something tough. You got to move. You know, when in the church, when we tell you that you got to do something different, do it. Try. Because you got to grow. You got to do something in the ministry. So how do I increase this zeal for God? What do? I said last time, stay away from things that defocuses you. If you want to increase God's zeal in you, you must decrease the world's zeal in you. You cannot get excited, being in the world and plus excited being the Lord. It doesn't work that way. Either one, you got to commit yourself. And that's the biggest challenge, no? As a Christian, we want to be there in the world, in the society. We want to do what they're doing. At the same time, when we come to our church zone, we will do what the church is telling us to do. But that is not acceptable in the sight of God. God is saying that you cannot compromise with the standard of God. God never compromised. You and I should never compromise. Bible says you cannot put one leg in one boat and another leg in another boat. You will fall down. You cannot serve two masters. You cannot serve Baal and you can't serve God together. In other words, it says you cannot serve both money and... it says over there, in one of the words it says, money is not evil. The love of money is the root cause of all evil. Promotion is not bad. Accepting good offers are not bad. But your desire of wanting more and more, that is bad. I'm repeating what I'm saying. Promotion is not bad, earning money is not bad, but your desire of having more and more, that is bad. That is bad. You'll ask me how? Where's the scripture for this? Godliness with contentment is great gain. It's a great gain. As a Christian, we got to learn to be content. We got to learn to be satisfied. If you're going to want more and more, how will your zeal for God grow then? Because you know what's going to happen? You want more, 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 more. But somewhere you have to put full stop, no. Finally, why is God giving you more? It's not because I want more. Sorry. No, no. It's what God wants to give you. Say loudly, no, amen. It's not about I cannot say, you know, to my, when I'm talking to my wife or my family or my, or someone in my professional life, you know what, I want to do this, I want more. But that is not God's will for you. As a Christian, you can't do that. So what are you supposed to say? God willing, if God wants me to grow, I'll grow. Because you know, when God gives you growth, hear this very carefully, when God gives you growth in your professional life, in your family life, in your material life, when God gives you growth, there will never be an obstacle for you to grow. You agree with me? Make sense? See, so if you're doing some project work and that is causing you not to spend time with the Lord, that is not giving you time to pray, that is not giving you time to spend time with the family, that is not giving you time to spend time with the church, then there's a problem somewhere. Either you demanded for that project and God gave it, because God never says no. No, God is a good God. He says no, He's a very merciful God. Ask and you shall receive, seek and you shall find, knock and the door will open. Why? Because you are the righteousness of God. Say, I am the righteousness of God. You, the day you accepted Christ in your life, you became the righteousness of God. I told you this earlier. You are the righteousness of God. But we need to cap our desires. We need to cap what we want in this world. Okay, I need basic necessity of life. But you got to define what is basic, my friends. Because that's going to become a really big question mark. Some people's basic are not basic. Some people's basic is more than luxury. This is my basic. But think about Jesus. No. Jesus was a professional. He was a professional carpenter. Carpenter's son. He also was into business. He could have earned a lot of money. But he got into the ministry because he said, no, that's enough. Now it's time for me. God has told me to get in. It's time for me to reach the gospel. You and I have to think like that. So that means only Jesus was allowed to sacrifice what? His job, his career, his profession. Certainly, I'm not asking you to give up everything and get into mission. But all I'm trying to make you understand is that you can't be defocused. Because if you're defocused, then your zeal will slowly and steadily dry out. What you were zealous for God 2 years back, that zealous is no longer there, my friends. Go home and just do an examination of yourself. Find out. I told you the third way to increase your zeal is keep attending these Christian meetings, teaching seminars, prayer groups, church. Don't miss that. Because there you'll be fed the word of God. There you'll be encouraged. As iron sharpens iron, so one man sharpens another. That's why we tell you go for meetings. That's why we always encourage you, go, don't miss. Even if there are three people in that house, don't miss such meetings. It's enough. You will encourage one another. So that is why your zeal is not increasing. There are some of you over here who are not attending house group. I don't know why. I don't know what is the challenge. Why are you not attending prayer groups? Then how will your zeal increase? So the question now comes is, do I really want to be zealous for God? But you know, it is the other way around. If you notice, we are very zealous for our job. Very zealous. Tora bimar bhi hai, fir bhi jayega kaam pe. Very zealous. Agree with me? Hai na? Overtime, you must come. I have to go. That time you're not zealous. That time you have no choice either which way. We are zealous to do the things of the world, but we are not zealous to do the things of God. My question to you is why? So if you want to increase the excitement, many people say, "Are how he's so excited? Look at that guy, that brother. Ooh, wow, he's so excited. Wow." And sometimes some of us ridicule such people also. Oh, see, he's jumping. Ha ha ha. Kya joke bana raha hai? He's making a joke out of himself. See how he's jumping. Oh, he's showing off. He's trying to show off. Some people dance in the Lord. Some people shake and dance, shake their hands. Some people come and talk big things about the Lord. And some of us ridicule such people. I don't know why you ridicule them. Maybe that is zeal without knowledge, but that is still zeal. Knowledge, he will have to pursue knowledge. That's a different thing. But we can't afford to decrease our zeal for God. Are you understanding what I'm saying? Do you understand what is the meaning of zeal? Are you understanding the meaning of zeal? Zeal is excitement, adventurous, something happening. Every time you're bubbling for Christ. Nothing wrong in that. I told you that, find out your calling and work on it. Every one of you has a calling for the Lord. Some of you are called to be teachers of the Word of God. Some of you are called to be evangelists. Some of you are called to administer in the church. Some of you are called to do some office work in the church. Some of you are called, like we have just opened the Less Live Life domain. Some of you are blessed and skilled to get into those domain work. Get involved. Every one of you has a calling. Some of you sitting over here don't recognize your calling still. I don't know why. It's not challenging. You just have to pray and ask the Lord to show you your calling. And then work on it. You'll be zealous for God. Read lives of people who has the zeal of God. Engage in doing some work for the church. Allow the Spirit of God to lead you and be completely dependent on Him. Rebuke the spirit of shame and fear. I'm not going into detail too much. I already spoke about this. Rebuke the spirit of shame and fear. We need to get rid of shame. There are some of you still, I can sense in my spirit, you are too ashamed of declaring yourself as a Christian in front of non-Christians. Be proud. Be a proud Christian. Oh, who are you? What faith are you? Christian. Who do you believe in? They don't know Jesus, no? God. You go to church or what? I go. So what do you do as a Christian? No, nothing. Something you must be doing, no? Yeah, we pray at times at home. We read little Bible. You are so shy to talk about your faith. What, somebody put a knife on your neck or what? You accepted Christ by your own will only, no? Anybody who was forced to accept Jesus, meet me after the service. Your declaration of your faith and your confession of accepting Christ is your own personal decision. Nobody can force you. Nobody can force you to accept Christ. You understand what I'm saying? Jesus says, you know, come to me all who are weary and burdened, I will give you rest. He never said, all who are weary and burdened, you must come to me right now. I give you no choice. You see, you read the life of Jesus, the way he communicated with people. He always gave them a choice. He never forced anybody. You're not forced to accept Christ, you understand? It's your personal decision. So why are you scared? If somebody says, okay, what do you believe in? I believe in Jesus. Yeah. Some chance we got to say, no, Jesus. Are you Christian? Yes, I'm a Christian. I go to a church near TMA Hall. I worship there. Why don't you come and check it out sometime? Oh, wow. Very nice. So instead of now you going lower, the person opposite you is going lower. Oh, okay. Christian, are bhag jao idhar se. Don't feel shy. In your society meetings, with your friend circle in college, they talk all about today's generation, no? All top terminology words. You say Jesus, old stuff. Oh, very old he is there. Old style. It's okay. Old is gold. Hallelujah. Jesus is still famous today also. I like to say that all the time. The other day I told my friends, you know what? One man was famous, is famous, and will always be famous. He said, who? Jesus. He said, yeah, that's right. He agreed to me, yeah. I was shocked. Yeah, Jesus, huh? Jesus is very famous. Tehelka! Garma garam! Kaun? Yeshu Masi. Wo garma garam spirit is inside you. So why you're thanda then? Question, no? Question. Answer that question now. Why are you thanda? You also be a little bit bubbly, you know, in the spirit. What is wrong? Nothing will happen. Max to mass, people will call you mad. Like some guys in my office call me mad. So I got a nice term. Madman! He called me mad. I said, you're mad or what? I said, yeah, you think I'm mad? And so be it. So get out of my way. And I'll destroy you. This zeal is for God. It's not stupidity. It's not foolishness. You're standing for the Lord Jesus. Don't get scared of your faith, my friends. Hold on to your faith. It's good. Jesus is true God. He's proved to be a true God. There is 1 crore, 2 crore, 10 crore God. Jesus is one God. That's it. We don't need anybody else. It's proven. Jesus proved it. I told you, next thing is zeal. You have to learn. You got to think about it every day. How do I get excited for God? You know, Galatians 2:20, I have been crucified with Christ. I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I live now in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself up for me. I told you this. If you say this every day, if you just listen to what I'm telling you, just say this every day in front of the mirror, your life will change. Has anybody done that till now? No, listening to the instruction of the man of God is very important also. Look in the Bible. No matter how stupid it was, when the man of God says go, matlab go. Do, matlab do. Then the results will come. So, look yourself in the mirror every day and confess. I have been, you'll keep thinking about this every day, and you'll bypass this verse, by the way. That's another good thing. However, Bible also says, my people perish due to lack of knowledge. In another 10 minutes, I'm going to cover up knowledge. My people perish due to lack of knowledge. Let's flip some verses. Let's flip some pages in the Bible. Proverbs 1:7. Can somebody really quick read? Whoever gets it, just read it. Don't wait for the next person. Proverbs chapter 1, verse 7. Amen. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Now we are talking about knowledge. Now we know about zeal. We have to get excited. We cannot afford to not get excited in the Lord Jesus. We got to get hot. We got to get ready for the Lord. But now we got to contain that zeal with knowledge. Then that's very powerful. Zeal with knowledge is powerful stuff. So the Bible says here, fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. So what do you do? If I have to start knowing that, okay, I want to know Christ. I want to know who is Christ. I told you that there's a process of knowledge. The first knowledge that you ever got is when you accepted Christ in your life. You did not know head or tail about Jesus, but God touched you. You got convicted by the Holy Spirit. And so you declared your faith by saying, I believe in Jesus. Even I did it. I remember when I accepted Christ. I can't forget that day. I gave my life to Christ. I did not know anything about Jesus. I only know the spelling of Jesus. J-E-S-U-S. That's it I know. But I knew one thing, that the Spirit of God touched me. And I knew in my spirit, this is true. And I surrendered. I said a salvation prayer. I said, Lord, from today, you are the King of my life. I'm going to follow you all the days of my life. So that's one knowledge. That's the initial process knowledge. That's faith. But there is a second level of knowledge that we all have to know. It's not enough only to know Jesus. Just, okay, I accepted Jesus in my life. That's it. I'm saved. I'm done and dusted. No. You got to study about this man now. You got to study about his principles. You got to study about his life. You got to study about what he expects you and me to do now. You got to study about his nature. You got to study about his father, God, Abba God. God of Abraham, God of Isaac, God of Jacob. Who are these people? What are people talking about? What was Jesus talking about? What is Jesus talking about love? What is Jesus talking about holiness? I have to learn. How would you know all this? You have to read. I told you to get knowledge, to attain knowledge. It's a very simple thing, yet very difficult. You have to do a systematic study of the Word of God every day. There is no other way out, my friends. I'm sorry. There is no other way out. If you want to, I know there are some people I know, very intellectual people. The other day I met someone who was a PhD. Good, solid, good guy, a good knowledge, intellectual. I said, what do you know about the Bible? He said, I've read it 10 times. I said, great. So what do you know about the Bible? No, I read it 10 times, but what do you know? You know nothing. You know, God has chosen the fools to shame the wise. Because, you know, that's what, we are not talking about half knowledge, we are talking about full knowledge. So you are reading the Bible every day, you are understanding what the Word of God talks about. You are reading something from the Bible, you have to do some examination of that verses. What does it mean? Can I Google and check what does it mean? Oh, do I have a Bible study book so I can refer to other verses, study it? That is what I told you. Your Bible meditation time is incomplete without a notebook. Your Bible meditation time is incomplete without a notebook. Do you have a dedicated notebook for your Bible when you're doing your Bible study? Your daily, you read Bible, no? How many of you read the Bible every day? How many of you meditate upon the Bible every day? So when you meditate, you need a notebook. Otherwise, that's not meditation, my friends. You're not studying the Bible. That's not knowledge. You're not getting solid knowledge. You're just reading it. Just and you know what happens because of that? When somebody in the office asks you, tell me, why did you accept Jesus? Why not this? Why not this? You don't have an answer because you don't have knowledge. One is you don't have knowledge. And if you have knowledge, the problem is there is no zeal. You're not excited to challenge the guy. You're scared. You know, it says in the verse that be ready in season and out of season to give an answer to anybody who asks you of the hope that you have. Somebody might come to you and say, tell me, why do you believe in this? What are you going to say? You've got to have some solid, you know, to know. You've got to have some content, you know, to talk. For that you have to read, no? Solomon, many people say, Solomon prayed for wisdom and bang, he got up in the morning, his eyes opened, he became a wise man. Is that how he became a wise man? He had to work on it. Of course, in the latter days, he messed up, but he worked on it. He was fearful of God. His wisdom all went in the middle part of his life because the fear of God went out of him. He started worshipping other gods and marrying, you know, forget, I don't know the number. Many wives, which God forbid not to do. So, wisdom, as brother read, is that fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, and fools despises instruction and wisdom. I told you last time, no? If you want to be a knowledgeable man, you have to learn to listen to instructions. Get this in your head. Yeah, in your mind. You might be an MBA, you might be a PhD, you might be a doctor, you might be whatever you are. But if you want the knowledge of God in your life, first learn to accept instructions. Bible is a book of instructions, my friends. One is that. Second is, God has also assigned leaders and men of God to help you in teaching, learning the Bible. When I do counseling, I tell people what I expect them to do. You have to do it. It's an instruction. You've got to learn to follow instructions. How will you be wise then? Tell me. Hallelujah. What are we talking about today? We already spoke about zeal. Now we are trying to club zeal and knowledge, because that's the best combination for you to know Christ and to do something for Christ. Hallelujah. Knowledge is attainable by daily and committed habit reading, meditating God's word on a daily basis. If you are devoted to keep God's word in your heart, you see, there's a condition over there. I will not go much detail, because I want to move ahead. We have less time and I want to finish it. I spoke to you about 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 1 onwards. If you read that ahead, I spoke to you how the process of knowledge starts. It starts with your faith. Remember I told you I accepted the Lord 21 years back. I put my faith in Christ. That's it, the end. No turning back. But that faith was the first step of my process of knowledge. The second thing that talks in this chapter, it talks about virtue. Add to faith, virtue. What is virtue? Virtue is excellence. What is excellence? Excellence is developing a very systematic habit to become good in something. If you want to be excellent in your work, if you want to be excellent in the project you have in your hand, if you want to be excellent in a book, what do you got to do? You got to study it in and out. You got to drown yourself in. That's how people become intelligent, no? People have good IQ, they say. They say IQ comes when you're born. I don't really agree with that. What, Solomon was very wise the day he came out of his mother's womb? No, he asked for wisdom and he was the wisest man on the planet. Huh? So your IQ, your intelligence will only come if you pursue to do the right things. Be excellent. What you have in your hand, learn it in and out. So add to your faith, virtue, excellence. Why now? Faith is fine. Good, you got faith. Now what after that? You can't brag about your faith without virtue, right? It's not going to work. But it says, add to virtue, now knowledge. That's the third process. Add to virtue, knowledge. So it gives us a little more understanding. How do I increase my intelligence? Increase the knowledge. Increase the knowledge. Try to buy out verses in the Bible. I always tell some people this, that whenever you have a bad situation in your life, like some of you, if you're going to a financial crisis, if some of you are falling sick all the time, if some of you are having a tough time, with your relationships, if some of you are having a tough time in your professional life, if some of you are not able to think straight, you're very defocused here, and you're doing all silly mistakes, foolish mistakes, there are verses for these specific situations. You know that? You know that? You're looking, you're just looking at me. Do you know that?
Yes.
Every situation that you face on a day-to-day life, Bible has given us provision for verses for that. Every situation has got a verse. Do you know that? Have you all have that? Do you have that verse ready with you all the time? Do you have it with you? Jab pyaas laga hai fir. People say, no? When you're thirsty, then you start? Hare Baba, you should know that you'll be thirsty. You should plan for all this. Get excited. Bible, let me tell you one thing. Bible has got all the answers of your life. It's a book full of answers. It's the book full of answers. And this is not some spiritual answer. Huh? They're very logical answers. Even if I talk, if I say Proverbs to my friend who doesn't know Jesus, no? If I tell him, you know what? I read today in Proverbs this verse. He said, wow, that's amazing. Amen. Bible fits everybody. So you need to have a verse. Go home, do the homework. Start learning. Put the verse in your, if you have a soft board at home, if you have some, stick it in your door. This is the verse. Oh no, I'm getting really restless and because too much of tension at home. Pick up that verse. Say that verse loudly. And in the course of time, you will be able to buy heart the verse also, because that's now the common verse. No, you'll be able to buy heart it. So whenever there's a trouble that hits you, buy heart one verse and declare that verse in the name of Jesus. There will be a breakthrough, because the word of God once confessed from your mouth shall not return void unless and until it accomplishes its purpose. When you release the word of God from the mouth, from your mouth, you release the word of God, I'm telling you, it will come back. It will come back with an answer. It will come back accomplishing its purpose. It's powerful stuff. Jesus says, heaven and earth will pass away, but my words shall never pass away. Never, 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 never. He doesn't use such words in other situations. He says, never. You don't use the word never. You use only for some specific situation. Jesus said, never, it will never pass away. Then what are you waiting for? What is the word? The word is the knowledge. How do you increase knowledge? Start reading the word of God every day. And that is one thing that a devil is not going to allow you to do. Notice, whenever you open the Bible, bore hota hai. Whenever you think I want to pray, it will not going to happen. You will have interest to do other things, huh? That may not be wrong. But when it comes to Bible, the interest level is gone. Because devil knows very well that the word of God has got power. If it settles in your heart, no friends, if it settles here in your heart, well, that's it. You don't need anybody to encourage you anymore. That's it. It's in your heart. Kuch bhi aane do. Storms, earthquakes in your life, what turmoil come, let it come. But once the word of God is settled in your heart, no? Nothing. Nobody can do anything to you. That's why the Bible says, what will the righteous man do if the foundations are broken? What is the foundation? Foundation is the word of God. Increase your knowledge. Very quickly, just a few more things, then we'll stop. I told you last time, God demands us that we need to know knowledge. We need to get knowledge. Somebody pick up Proverbs chapter 2 verse 1 to 5. Very quickly, Proverbs chapter 2 verse 1 to 5. Read it quickly. You don't have time. Read quickly. If you receive my words and treasure my commands within you. See, there's a condition. It starts with a condition. If you receive my word, are you guys ready to listen to receive the word of God in your life? If you receive the word of God, you see, the sower who sows the seed, he sowed the seed, and the seed that fell in good soil, it received it. It received it. Therefore, it multiplied. Therefore, there was productivity. So you got to receive whatever comes from the word. And then if you treasure my command with you. That's why David was very smart. Huh? David was very smart. He said in the word that thy word I have hidden in my heart that I might not sin against thee. Because he knows the word is the treasure. We look everywhere else for the treasure. But the treasure is the word of God. You're having a problem in your life. You are restless. You can't sleep in the night. But that is not the solution. The solution is you got to don't sleep in the night. If you're not getting sleep, it's okay. But instead of doing anything else, no? Thinking. What will happen? You keep thinking in the night, no? Restless. What will happen? Two things might happen. Either next day you will sleep full day. When you're supposed to work. Second thing, what will happen is that you have to visit a doctor. Pressure went up. Tension went up. What else happens when you don't sleep? Sochte rehte aadmi na, blood pressure goes up. Blood pressure. And then you feel, you get up in the morning, say, oh, I think I'm sick. You're not slept in the night. So instead of, if you still feel you can't sleep in the night, let's assume that your situation is really pathetic and you cannot sleep in the night. You're really going through some really bad situation in your life. I'm saying don't sleep in the night, but open the Bible and read at least. Make sense? I'm saying sleep, please sleep. In case you have decided that you don't want to sleep, don't watch. Some people, you know, they watch TV. Arey, neend nahi aa raha hai, bahut tension aa gaya. What they do? News channel. Christian channel. One man of good, praise God, you're hearing the, at least you're hearing the word of God. Thank God. But the more effective way, you get into the Word of God. You know, kneel down in the presence of God and shut your mouth. You don't, you're not getting sleep, no? Just kneel down and keep your mouth shut. Just be quiet. You don't know when you'll fall asleep. God will put you to sleep. That's one. Second, if you're looking for an answer, when you kneel down in the presence of God, you will get your answer from the Lord. Many people don't kneel down. My question is to you, that when was the last time you knelt down before the presence of God? Don't ask, don't answer. I don't know. I'm sorry, I don't want to know. You ask yourself that question. When was the last time you knelt down? A person who kneels down the maximum, no? Where? Not front of the world, in the presence of God. In the presence of God, the person who kneels down the maximum, I'll tell you, no devil in the world will ever, ever, ever be able to disturb that man. Powerful man. Powerful. This is powerful stuff. Don't take panga with such people. You know, Sachin shared a verse, the righteous cry unto the Lord and the Lord hears. Can you beat that? If you don't even have to cry, I'm telling you, if you are a person who kneels down in the presence of God, spends time in presence of God, that's it. Open the Bible, no. If you're not getting sleep, read, no. Or a business mein loss ho raha yaar, bahut tension ho raha. I don't know what to do tomorrow. I'm gone. No, you're not gone yet. Bible is there, no. Open the Bible, start reading. Find out the verses relevant to your problem. When you go to a doctor, what he does? You have a headache, what will he do? He'll give you cancer medicine, don't? You take this cancer medicine. Got headache, no? That's what people do spiritual life. It's a chota problem. But the way you all behave, you've got fire all around. This is a small problem. Don't exaggerate. Control yourself. You're very zealous that time. When the problem is small, the solution is also small, no? You go to a doctor, if your sickness is less, he will give you a little bit, not too much heavy medicine. You take this much and enough. No, doctor, I'll take more. No. I'm the doctor. Hold on. Do what I'm saying. Anytime you go to a doctor and say, doctor, 1 second. Hold on. Doctor, 1 second. I want to take 4 more. Doctor say, okay, you can go back. The door is behind you. You can walk out. I'm not going to suggest you anything of this sort. We got to learn to do that, friends. When you have a problem, find out the solution quickly. From the? If you can't find it, what are you going to do? Pray, but you still have to find, the verse. So if you can't find it, what are you going to do? Read the Bible. Bible is so big, yeah. By the time I read the Bible, it will become 3 years there. Sometimes people are still reading to finish the Bible. 10 saal gaya, you're still finishing. Abhi tak Bible, the Bible is such a terrific book, no? How many of you finished reading the Bible? Handful. Challenge yourself to read it, no? Chalo, I challenge you. Open challenge. Kar do. Ek saal mein khatam karega, my brother. Ek saal mein. Are Baba, hold on. But start reading. It's powerful stuff. Bible is powerful stuff. So if you can't find the verse, what is the next logical answer? What are you going to do? Call up your brother in the church, no Baba. Achha, next, don't call him middle of the night and wake him up. Next day when you get up, achha, brother, yaar, meko wo verse nahi mil raha, please tell me where's the verse. He will tell you where the verse. Oh, catch your house group leaders. Ask them, I can't find a verse, can you please help me? Or if you can't, hallelujah to Google. Google mein verse dalo. Sab milta hai baba. Oh, amazing technology. If you have internet, mobile pe bhi kar sakte hai Google. Depression, poverty, anger, foolishness. Put all that. Say search. Oh, you'll get many. You get documentaries on that. Don't read the documentary and get lost. Just get the verse out and buy the verse. You have to do something about your knowledge. And God demands it. We're not going to the verse. Last time we read Deuteronomy 6:6-9 says He expected Israel to have knowledge, to remember the word of God. Jeremiah 31, we read last time, 31-34. He foretold the new covenant, that He will write the covenant in your heart. He's such a personal God. And Colossians 1:9-10, to be pleasing to the Lord, we must have a knowledge of His will. If you want to please God, you must have a knowledge about His will. Very important. Then we will also speak about you can take these verses down. Proverbs chapter 2, verse 3 and 6. A heart that longs and searches for knowledge. Proverbs 8, verse 10 and 11 says, a mind that values knowledge is more highly than gold. We got to search knowledge. We got to be crazy for knowledge. That's why we have the library books out. You can ask CJ which book you want. Read books here. Read, it's good. Make a time to read your other books. Make a time to spend time with the Lord to read the word of God. You will never go wrong. So you'll have zeal and knowledge together. Both of them, friends, are a very important ingredient for you to grow in the Lord. Otherwise, it's very difficult for you to grow in the Lord. Sometimes people have too much knowledge. Don't destroy your brother with too much of knowledge. Know how much to talk, how much you need to speak. At times, you have to control yourself. Colossians 1 Corinthians chapter 8 verse 12 and 13, it talks about abuse of knowledge. 1 Corinthians chapter 8 verse 12 and 13, in fact it says over there that you actually go against Christ if you have knowledge and you destroy your brother. Paul is telling that the church of Corinthians over there. You can read that when you go home. And one last verse I like to give you. Go home and go through it. Romans chapter 14 verse 14-21. Talks about love should restrain your use of knowledge. There's nothing beyond love. Remember that. Nothing beyond love. Shall we just pray? Father in heaven, we thank you and bless you for this time.